I will keep it as short as possible, so I will skip a lot of general Slavic talk. My name is Geert Drummen, chief representative for SEBIC for the CIS market. I'm now 3 years in Moscow as head of the REP office, I Jan Nikavriu Paruski. I did a lot of work in Russian translations. There it is. So, what did I do? I had a presentation last year, and it's not that I was lazy. I thought, let's have a look back 1 year and see what has changed in the meantime. So I got to do quickly an introduction on SEBIC, and then I will readdress a few topics of last year. So first of all, SEBIC's global ambition. What is the ambition for the CIS market? And then I will readdress buying behavior, protectionism or import duties, and green. I like the discussion this morning about prices, too high prices, import duties, what will happen when Russia enters the World Trade Organization, and I will also come back to that. Pity that my colleague producers left. So, ambition is the same as last year. We want to be the leader in chemicals. And we are quite successful. We were established as a Saudi company in 76, have now 33,000 employees globally, working in more than 40 countries, and by now 60 world-class manufacturing locations. We are organized in 6 business units: chemicals, polymers, innovative plastics, I will come back to innovative plastics, performance chemicals, fertilizers, and metals. It's not all about polymers. The biggest unit is chemicals. If you look at the volumes, chemicals is 4 times bigger than polymers. Then fertilizers and metals is mainly focused on the Middle East. If you want to sell all those volumes, you cannot stay in the traditional markets of SEBIC. SEBIC started from the Middle East with the acquisition of DSM Petrochemicals. They got a strong foothold in Europe. But for the future, it's all about Asia, Latin America, and of course the CIS market, of which Russia is the biggest market. For that reason, we established end of 2008 our REP office here in Moscow. And I must say, we didn't do bad. We have good positions now in polyethylene and polypropylene pipe, LLDPE, the cast stretch film, LDP film and HDP film, and polycarbonates, where we also have quite a good position. What you will see more and more is that we also will focus on those innovative plastics. Engineering plastics in SEBIC is called SEBIC Innovative Plastics. For you who know the former GE Plastics, SEBIC acquired that in 2007. So let's have a short look at those innovative plastics. There's one unit, it's called base resins, selling polycarbonates, polycarbonates for building and construction, for packaging, for instance, water bottles, compounding, and optical media, for instance, DVDs. Then there are more sophisticated products for high-demanding applications, like lighting, appliances, TV, wire and cable with high demands. Most specialized are all kinds of applications for aviation, transportations, LED, and here some interesting projects also in Russia are going on. And last but not least, our automotive unit, which produces automotive applications based on PP compounds, and also based on, for instance, polycarbonate lighting. So you can think of bumpers, instrument panels, and all kinds of nice things. for enough about SEBIC. Last year I mentioned a few topics, personal observations, and one was the buying behavior. And if you remember well, I talked about price formulas and bonuses and contracts. And yeah, today there were a few people asking for that, so I'm very positively surprised. So as a petrochemical producer, you prefer regular buyers, because you have to plan your production, you want to be sure that you have the right product at the right place, with the right logistics. So in our business, it's all about planning. We have a very complex process, and the factories have to be fully loaded. For you, that's also the best. You also are sure that you can rely upon our availability. We can give you the best logistical costs, but also regular buyers get a credit limit. We have better service for regular customers, and you can also optimize your process. And if you are a nice regular customer, you can come to our customer event at the third of April. So suppose that we would have regular buying customers. We have two kinds of products: seasonal products, which is, for instance, HD pipe, and more regular products, for instance, LLDPE. So then you have two kinds of sales: the blue graph, the seasonal product, and the red graph. And if you add it all up, you get something looking like a green graph. However, reality is completely different. 2009 looked like this, 2010 like that, 2011 again. So, how come? If I looked at the import statistics of MRC, and that's the right graph, HDP pipe is the seasonal business. Please have a look. I don't see anything seasonal in that. And LL should be a regular business, and it's also not regular. So this is the total import in Russia. So the green line is not at all what you expect. So what is happening? Are the Russian producers not selling regularly? Or do our customers not, don't they have regular sales? Do they have to compete with external people? For that reason, I would really appreciate if MRC doesn't publish only imports, but perhaps also starts publishing the total sales in Russia and Ukraine. Because then you can see what is really happening in the market, and then we can follow our market share. So I guess they have indications, because at year end, they publish total figures. So for me, it would be very handy if we could have that on a monthly basis. If you then look at our graph, which first half of the year was completely different than second half of the year, I guess one big reason was the situation in Asia, where demand was low. There was tremendous difference in price levels between Europe and Asia. So material popped up from everywhere, and that played clearly a role in the first half. Then new producers came on stream, there were availability issues, etc., etc. But I think the main reason is still the opportunistic buying behavior. I think still that we are confronted with purchasers who only look at the cheapest price. Then protectionism. Did that change or improve? If you remember, I talked about the reason for protectionism should be that you want to protect your infant industries. But in fact, it harms both the producers as well as converters and end producers. With the producers, I made the remark that if you spoil your child too much, it will never grow up and it will never leave your house. Well, perhaps the same is applicable for a Russian producer. If he has a cost advantage of 10%, he can, prices will be 10% higher, or he can give less service and give you a price of 7% higher. So there is not enough stimulus to be best. Then looking at converters, they also pay a too high price. If they have to compete with foreign converters who bring the ready product to this market, the foreign converters have much better access to cheaper material because they are the market demand and supply does its work. So, did it improve? Did I have a good story last year? For sure not. It became worse. First of all, there was a customs union now between Russia, Belarus and Kazakhstan, meaning that those high import duties spread from Russia to Belarus and to Kazakhstan. So suddenly we are confronted with 10% import duties. And this is again in the advantage of Russian producers. Then Sibyl had good contacts with Medvedev. I talked to Putin and he is working on a free trade zone which might even cause that the import duty system of Russia will spread to the whole CIS market. There is light in the tunnel, was mentioned a few times today, the access of Russia to the World Trade Organization. So if everything goes well, then middle of the year, Russia will become a World Trade Organization. And I couldn't find it, but today I heard that it will mean that in 2 years' time, import duties will be reduced to 6.5%. So that means July 2014. So I will ask my boss to prolong the stay here in Moscow, that I can have that exciting moment when the import duties go to 6.5%. That's still 3.5% higher than in Europe, where it's 3%. So, green was another topic. What I told you last year is that plastics are too valuable to throw away. If you look at Western Europe, there are countries where the percentage of plastic collection is close to 100%. And in Russia, I don't see it at all, and I don't see any movement. So, I don't know, we will have a discussion on PET, but quickly things can happen in this industry. Suddenly, somebody blames your plastic for something, and you have a big case. So as industry, you have to manage the perception of plastics. Did something happen? But I was I had the pleasure to be invited at the Rosnano Forum here in Moscow, where Mr. Chubais gave this presentation. He says, if you look at material consumption and energy consumption, it all tremendously increased since the 1950s. Same for mankind, have we reached 7 billion people end of October, and CO2 concentration also extremely increases. So if you all add it up, you get a very steep line which cannot continue. It must somewhere end, and it can be a crisis, or you bend the line, and that's what he hopes to do with nanotechnology. So with nanotechnology, that form or the organization hopes to find new materials and ways of reducing energy consumption, which might help in the whole issue. Well, to my opinion, I believe in nanotechnology. I'm sure that, for instance, you can make catalysts who use less energy. And I'm also very much interested in projects where they can reduce the film thickness. And Danaflex claims that they will reduce multi-layer films, like 7-layer films, to 1 or 2 layer films. That would be a tremendous downgauging. But why not start simple and just start with collection and recycling of plastics? So I again ask, is it possible to have a kind of plastics association in Russia which looks after the interests of the plastic industry. In Europe, there is Plastics Europe, and it must be possible to make something similar here in Russia. It could also be an organization. If something happens like PET, they try to inform the people in the right way. And there are much more discussions and cases in the field of plastics. Then at SEVIC, we have a project, it's called Let's Talk Plastics, where we inform our employees about the real things of plastics. Plastics is in many cases better than glass, paper, or wood. And starting with your own employees, you create ambassadors for plastic in the environment. But it's a public site, you can all visit it, www.letstopplastics.com. Then also SEVIC goes green. We have also bioplastics project, and that will consist of both bio-based plastics, so using raw materials that are bio, but also biodegradable plastic. I don't have concrete products at the moment, but for sure it will come. So that was everything in short. I'm ready for your questions right now. Otherwise, there are two colleagues of me here. We can talk to you after the break.
Пока нет, но они у нас есть на электронной почте. Так, они пришли по сути, я постараюсь перевести. Get the report. Got some questions by email, and I will try to translate them for you. Do you expect the certification of PE100 for bioproduction, which is produced in Saudi Arabia?
Yes. It's actually already certified. We're just going through the last procedures, but as from next year's. Next year, we will have all certification in place.
Отлично, можно только поздравить компанию SEVIC. Получить сертификацию достаточно мне тяжело. А вы ее получили где, в России, да?
No, that is the second step. So you first get your certification in Western Europe.
Uh-huh.
And then...
Понял, замечательно. You have mentioned many times that this summit, I guess last summit, that there is a great shortage of high-quality polyethylene for bioproduction on the territory of CIS. Does SEVIC have a strategy to conquer this market of polyethylene?
Yeah, so first of all, we have a huge capacity, which is a kind of starting point. You need to have the volume to be there, to be a big player. And there was today several talks about the logistics shield. We are trying to crack the logistics shield.
And I guess the last question, that's from Sergei Yeremenko. Have you got sizable results on the Russian market thanks to your very aggressive trading policy over the last 2 years?
Yeah. That's always a strange question. If I talk to my customers, they always say that we are much too expensive and there are other companies selling much cheaper. So we are not aggressive. We just try to get our market share. And results are good. We have the market share we want and we want to grow further.
Great. Пожалуйста.
Regarding SABIC's PVC, I have a question. SABIC is a very big player in Middle East in PVC, right? So is there any strategy that SABIC wants to enter the Russian market with its PVC? And if it is yes, then when? And if it is not, then why?
It's a very good remark. We started very hopeful. But then there was a decision to delay, so we will retract for a while, can be 1 year, can be 2 years, and then come back. So we concentrate again back on Middle East, that has to do with profit optimization. but as soon as capacity increases, you will come back. Is that a good answer?
So we can expect that SABIC is not our competitor for coming 2 years, right?
Yes, be happy.
Еще вопросы из Алуд? Да, пожалуйста. Последняя сессия, я думаю, что будет самая продуктивная.
Вы упомянули по поводу участия в нанотехнологическом саммите. Есть ли у фирмы достижения в области свойств полимерных материалов и изделий из них с использованием нанотехнологий?
No. So, I talked to researchers inside our organization, and there are also some severe doubts. They say much of it is old things in new, new packaging. But for sure, we are looking, we are investigating it, and probably we will also participate in one or two projects of Rosnan. So it's the future, but for which term? We also are a bit hesitant. So you will see us there, probably. But like I said, with the green stuff, it's not something for the short term. It will take considerable time. If you talk about catalysts or barrier film properties, then it's quite close. But real nanotechnology is something for the longer term. But I really appreciate the initiative. It's very good what has been done in a structured way, investing in research and high-tech industry of Russia. I think it's a very good project.